Hi guys, welcome back to Learning with JD. So as you know that we are now covering the knowledge areas. We've already talked about integration and stakeholders. Today we are going to talk about scope. Scope being a little larger concept as a whole, in today's session, we will talk about the first four processes of scope, which is a part of the planning process group. So we are going to talk about how do we plan the scope? So what all components include while planning the scope? We are going to see how will we collect the requirements as to what the product is going to be all about, what do you want to, you know, build your product, your service or your result. And we are also going to see how we are going to define our scope, and we are also going to create our WBS. So these are the four processes that we are going to touch upon in today's session, because in the next one, then we will talk about monitoring and controlling. Yeah. All right. So let's begin. So what is scope management? Project scope management includes the process of two important concepts. One, ensuring that the project includes all the work required. Everything, all the actual work of that will be the output of your project, all that what needs to be done is a part of your scope management, and only the work required to complete the project successfully. So that also includes that not just what needs to be done, but also to ensure that only what needs to be done is also a part of it. There should be no scope creep. Anything which is not a part of the scope, which is not a part of your project, should not be a part of your scope management. Managing the project scope is the responsibility of the project manager. Very important that it is a project manager who ensures that the scope is within the limits and within the boundaries and within whatever has been decided. Yeah. Managing the project scope is primarily concerned with defining and controlling what is in and what is not included in the project. So what is a part of it and what is not a part of the project is a part of scope management. In the project context, the term scope can refer to two: product scope and project scope. Product scope includes the features, the functionality, the characteristics of how the product will be, how the service will be, how the result will be. And what do you mean by a project scope? Does work performed to deliver the product, the service or the result? What is it that you're going to do? What is the work that you will be doing to create a product which will have the features and the functionalities as defined in the product scope? So that is all the part of the project scope. The term project scope is sometimes viewed as including product scope. The project scope should include the product scope. Yeah. Now let's see what are the trending and emerging practices around this. Requirements have been a concern in the project management and have continued to gain more attention in the profession. It is always important that you ensure that all the requirements, whatever is a part of the product, is always been a concern. Even if it is a small project or a large project, we've seen that some or the other time the requirements is a concern. Trending and emerging practices for project scope management includes, but not limited to a focus on collaborating with business analyst professionals to determine problems and identify the business needs, identify and recommend viable solution for meeting those needs. Two important things that as a project manager you will do is that you will understand, you will determine the problems and identify the business needs. What is, whether the business need is actually there or no. And then identify and recommend viable solution. What is the best possible solution for doing that project, for meeting those needs? So elicit, document and manage stakeholder requirements in order to meet the business and project objectives. Facilitate the successful implementation of the product, service or an end result of the program or the project. So these are some of the trending and emerging practices. The process ends with the requirements closed, which transitions the product, service or the result to the recipient in order to measure, monitor, realize and sustain benefits over time. So that's where the process ends, with the requirement closure, with the transition of the product and the service and the result to whoever had asked for it, in order to measure, monitor, realize and sustain benefits over time. Now let's see what are the tailoring considerations around this. Why do you need tailoring consideration? We've spoken about this before also, because each project is unique. Some of the tailoring consideration considered under scope are knowledge and requirement management, validation and control, development approach, stability of requirement and governance. These are the five important concepts that as a project manager, you should be taking care. You can read about all this in quite detail in PMBOK. So as we know, there are six processes under project scope management. Plan scope management. We will start with plan scope management and we are going to cover the first four, which are the part of planning, in today's session. In next session, we are going to talk about monitoring and controlling. So plan scope management is the process of creating a scope management plan. So the entire project management plan has all the subsidiary management plan. The scope management plan is also a part of the project management plan. We've spoken about this before also, that it defines how are you going to collect your requirement, how are you going to define your requirements, how are you going to create your WBS. All that will be a part of your scope. How are you going to monitor your scope? All that will be a part of the scope management plan. So plan scope management is the process of creating a scope management plan that documents how the project and the product scope will be defined, validated and controlled. All the three aspects, that is defining, validating and controlling your scope. The key benefit of the process is that it provides guidance and direction, on how the scope will be managed throughout the project. Yeah, so that is the understanding of plan scope management. So now let's see what is the inputs that you need. So what do you mean by inputs and outputs? These are nothing but documents. And what are tools and techniques? But nothing but the methodology of doing or creating a particular document. Now what document do you need while you create your scope management plan? First, of course, you need the project charter. Why do you need the project charter? Because it defines the high-level project description, assumptions, constraints, and high-level requirements that the project is intended to satisfy. So all these are a part of your project charter. Then you have the project management plan. So all the other subsidiary management plans that have been created till now are a part of project management plan, and you need all of them to define your scope, your quality management plan, your project lifecycle descriptions, your development approach. All these are a part of the project management plan. Then you need your EEFs, because you want to know what is happening within your organization, outside of your organization. EEFs is something which do not have a control, in which the project team or the project manager does not have a control on. These are organizational cultures, the infrastructure, personal administration, marketplace condition. All these are a part of EEFs. Then you also need your OPAs, organizational process assets. Why? Because your policies, your procedures, your historical information, lessons learned, everything is a part of organizational process assets. Now let's see what are the tools and techniques. So you have your project charter, you have your project management plan, you have EEFs and OPAs. So these are the documents that you've taken, and now you want to create your scope management plan. How are you going to create your scope management plan? Expert judgment. You can call experts. Experts should be any individual or group with specialized knowledge or training. Experts can come and help you define the scope of your project or your product. They are the people who have expert knowledge in the specific stream or training. Data analysis, various ways of collecting requirements. So understand that you are at the stage of what scope now. So you need to do a lot of data analysis at this point of time. So various ways of collecting requirement, elaborating the project and the product scope, creating the product, validating the scope and controlling the scope are evaluated. So at this point of time, you are trying to evaluate all these stuff. And then meetings. Project teams may attend project meetings to develop a scope management plan. It is always better to involve your project team because while your project team is a part of the meetings of defining the project scope management plan, attendees may include project manager and project sponsor, selected project team members, selected stakeholder, anyone with responsibility for any other scope management plan, and other as needed. Anyone with responsibility for any other scope management processes and others as needed. These all participants can be a part of your meetings. Now, what is it that we create? What is the output, right? So output is obviously the scope management plan. What is scope management plan? Nothing but a component of the project management plan that describes how the scope will be defined, developed, monitored, controlled, and validated. All the other components that will be a part of the scope management plan will include process for preparing the scope statement, process for enabling the creation of WBS, process for establishing the scope baseline, process for establishing how formal acceptance of the project deliverables will happen. So all these will be a part of the scope management plan. Then you also have your requirement management plan. The requirement management plan is a component of the project scope of the project management plan. Again, so requirement management plan is a component of the project management plan, like the scope management plan, that describes how the project and the product requirements will be analyzed, documented, and managed. So other components that will be a part of the requirement management plan are how requirement activities will be planned, tracked, and reported. Configuration management activities, including how changes will be initiated, how impact will be analyzed, how they will be traced, tracked, and reported, as well as authorization levels required to approve these changes. These are all a part of the requirement management plan. Got that? So now you've got two important outputs, that is your scope management plan and requirement management plan. Now let's jump to the second process of planning under project scope management, that is collect requirement. Now you've actually done how you're going to collect it. Now you will actually collect the requirements. Collect requirement is the process of determining, documenting, and managing stakeholders' needs and requirements to meet objectives. The key benefit of the process is that it provides the basis for defining the product scope and the project scope. At this point of time is where you are actually collecting your requirements. Everything what is has to be a part of the project and the product will now be collected with your stakeholders. So you remember we did stakeholder management in the previous session. At this point of time, you are now going to do the collection requirement with the stakeholders. Let's see what are the inputs that we require for collecting your requirements. You need the project charter. Why? Because the project charter documents the high-level project descriptions and high-level requirements. Whatever needs is mentioned in the project charter will now be detailed out. Yeah. Then you need the project management plan. It also includes the scope management plan that was created in the previous session, that was plan scope management, requirement management plan, similarly from the same process, and stakeholder engagement plan. Remember, we created stakeholder engagement plan, which is now an input to the project management plan. And you also need your project documents. Your project documents includes your assumption logs, your lessons learned, and your stakeholder register. You remember stakeholder register was created while we did stakeholder management. Why? Because you need to see who are the stakeholders from whom you have to collect the requirements. You also need your business documents. The business documents that can influence the collect requirement process is the business case, which can describe requirement, desired, and optional criteria for meeting the business needs. You also need your agreements. Agreements can contain project and product requirements. You also need your EAFs and your OPAs. Organizational culture, infrastructure, personal administration, marketplace conditions. And from your OPA perspective, the policies, procedures, your lessons learned. EAFs and OPAs are generally an input for all the processes. Why? Because you always have to keep an eye as a project manager as to what is happening within your project, within your organization, and within the enterprise. Now let's see what are the tools and techniques for collecting the requirement. Expert judgments. I told you experts get job everywhere. You can call experts to help you collect requirements. You have data gathering techniques for collecting requirement. You can do brainstorming sessions with the team. So you have stakeholder register in which the names of the stakeholders are mentioned. You can do brainstorming sessions with all of them. You can do interviews with your stakeholders to understand what their requirements are. You can do focus group discussions, questionnaires and surveys, and benchmarking. Benchmarking for what is happening in the industry and what is it that you as an organization are planning to achieve. So these are all the data gathering techniques. Then you will do data analysis. We also said that you have data gathering, which means you just collect the data. Then when you have the data, you try to do some data analysis on that. Data analysis techniques that can be used for this process include, but are not limited to, document analysis. Document analysis is something where you have the entire data received from the stakeholders and you try to do some analysis on that document. Document analysis consists of reviewing and accessing any relevant documented information. Decision-making techniques can be used in collect requirement process, including voting, autocratic decision-making, and multi-criteria decision-making. Then you will now do data representation, affinity diagrams. Affinity diagrams allow large number of ideas to be classified into groups for review and analysis. You can even do mind mapping. Mind mapping consolidates ideas created through individual brainstorming sessions into a single map to reflect commonality and differences in understanding and to generate new ideas. Then you will also use the tool and technique of interpersonal and team skills. Interpersonal and team skills that can be used in this process are nominal group techniques. The nominal group techniques enhances brainstorming with voting process, used to rank the most useful idea for further brainstorming. What do you mean by brainstorming? It is not about collecting people and just talking randomly. It's about having one agenda point and then brainstorming and then talking about that one single agenda point or that one particular goal, the end goal. Nominal group is a combination of brainstorming as well as along with voting. So you will first do the voting to prioritize on the ideas, and on that typical on that idea which is the most important or prioritized one, you will further do brainstorming. Observation and conversation. You will talk to your stakeholders. You will do observation and conversation, provide a direct way of viewing individuals in their environment and how they perform their job or task and carry out processes. So you need to observe a lot of stakeholders to understand what their requirements is, what is the key issues that they are facing in their current challenges, in their current workspace, so that you can fix up their challenges. Then facilitation. Facilitation is used with focus sessions that bring key stakeholders together to define product requirements. These are all ways of interpersonal and team skills. Then context diagram. The context diagram is an example of a scope model. Yeah. Context diagram visually depicts the product scope by showing a business system and how people and other systems interact with it. So that is also a tool and technique of collecting your requirement. Prototyping. You can create prototypes. You can create prototypes. You can share it with your stakeholders to understand what their requirements is. Have they to receive feedback from them? Have they perceived it in a positive or a negative manner? Prototyping is a method of obtaining early feedback on requirement by providing a model of the expected product before actually building it. Like most of the time you see prototyping in infrastructure, where a prototype is created of a complex or a building or a flyover of a dam to get approval. Examples of prototyping are small scale products, computer generated 2D and 3D models, mockups or simulators. Prototypes allow stakeholders to experiment with a model of a final product rather than being limited to discussing abstract requirement of their abstract representation of their requirement. So what is the output now? So you've collected your requirement with any of the tool and technique which are available, and you get your requirement documentation. Requirement documentation describes how individual requirements meet the business need for the project. Requirements may start out at a high level and become progressively more detailed as more information about the requirement is known. So at the beginning, when you create your requirement document, you may have some individual requirement which is mapped to the business needs. But as and when the project planning proceeds, requirement document gets more and more exhaustive. Some of the parts which are a part of the requirement document are: requirements can be grouped into classification, allowing further refinement and detailing as the requirements are elaborated. Some of them are business requirements, stakeholder requirement, solution requirement, transition and readiness requirement, project requirement, and quality requirement. So these are all a part of your collect requirement. You also get your requirement traceability matrix. What is a traceability matrix? It traces back to who the stakeholder was. The requirement traceability matrix is a grid that links the product requirement from their origin to the deliverables that satisfy them. From the end to the from the start till the end, it will trace the entire requirements by which stakeholder it was given, what was the need of it, what was the origin of it, and then whether it has been delivered or no. It provides a means to track requirement throughout the project lifecycle, helping to ensure that requirements approved in the stakeholder documentation are delivered at the end of the project. Move on to the third process, which is the defining scope. So you've planned your scope, you've collected your requirement with the help of some tools and techniques, you've got your stakeholder management plan ready, you've got the requirement management plan ready, and you've got your requirement documentation ready. Now we'll see the how you're going to define the entire scope, as to this is the scope of work. Now till now, what is the difference between collect requirement and defining scope? Collect requirement is that you've been speaking to all the stakeholders. You've got all the information from all the stakeholders. Now you want to define it to a particular scope. Define scope is the process of developing a detailed description of the project and the product. The key benefit of this process is it describes the product, service, or result boundaries and acceptance criteria. It defines as to what is the acceptance criteria for this project and what are the boundaries of your product, service, and results. So these are the, it defines the detailed description of the project and the product. What are the inputs that you need? You need the project charter. Why? We know, because it has the high level project description. Then you need the project management plan. Project management plan includes all the subsidiary management plans, including the scope management plan. And you need your project document, because it has the assumption logs, the risk register, and the requirements documentation. You remember, requirement documentation is an output from where? The previous process, that is collect requirement. Then you need your EAFs and your OPAs. Let's see what are the tools and techniques. The first one, expert judgment. You will call experts. Experts will help you defining your scope. You will have data analysis. Alternative analysis can be used to evaluate ways to meet the requirement. You are going to find out how will we meet the requirements and objectives identified in the charter. That is the first part of it, right? Decision making techniques. A decision making technique that can be used in the process includes multi-criteria decision analysis. And you also have interpersonal and team skills. An example of an interpersonal and team skill is facilitation. Facilitation is used in workshops and working sessions with key stakeholders who have a variety of expectation or fields of expertise. Then you can also do your product analysis. Product analysis can be used to define products and services. It includes asking questions about the product or service and forming answers to describe the use, the characteristics, and other relevant aspects of what is going to be delivered. Yeah. So what is the output that you get here? The output that you get is the project scope statement. This can be a 1-mark question for you. A project scope statement is an output of, it's of defined scope. The project scope statement is the description of the project scope, major deliverables, assumptions, and constraints. The project scope statement documents the entire scope, including the project and the product. It describes the project's deliverable in detail. It also provides a common understanding of the project scope among project stakeholders. The detailed project scope statement includes product, scope, description, deliverables, acceptance criteria, and project exclusion. You remember at the beginning we said what is in and what is not in. That is also very important. Hence, the project exclusions are equally important. Then the project documents get updated. Your assumption log may get updated after defining the scope. The requirement document may get updated, requirement traceability matrix, and your stakeholder register. After defining the scope, some new stakeholders may also arise. So your stakeholder register may get updated. Planned your scope, collected requirement, defined the scope. Now you are going to create a WBS. Now let's see what is creation of a WBS. Now create WBS is the process of subdividing project deliverables. So you have got deliverables at a high level at this point of time. You are now going to divide it at a work package level. Create WBS is the process of subdividing the project deliverables and project work into smaller, more manageable components. The key benefit of this process is that it provides a framework of what has to be delivered and what is not to be delivered. Let's see what are the inputs that we require for creating a WBS. Project management plan. Now at this point of time, you don't need the project charter. Why? Because you already consolidated everything and it is a part of your project management plan. A project management plan component includes the scope management plan. Scope management plan documents how the WBS will be created. You remember in the scope management plan, we were writing all the answers to how. That is what we are going to do here. We want to know how we are going to create our WBS. You need the project document, the project scope statement. When did we create the project scope statement? During the define scope. And the requirements document. When did we create requirement document? During collect requirement. You need both these documents for further breaking down the requirements at a more manageable component. You need your EES, you need your OPEs, all the procedures, everything that is happening, all this is the part of your EEFs and OPEs. Let's see what are the tools and techniques that will be used for creating your WBS. So expert judgment will be, experts will be coming to help you out in creation of your WBS. Decomposition, one mark question 100% comes here. Decomposition is a technique used for dividing and subdividing the project scope and project deliverables into small, more manageable parts. The project work, the work package is the work defined at the lowest level of the WBS for which cost and duration can be estimated and managed. So at this point of time, your work package is the smallest and the lowest in the WBS and at which what level the cost and the duration will be estimated and managed. The level of decomposition is often guided by the degree of control needed to efficiently manage the project. The level of detail for project package will vary from company to company, the size and the complexity of the project. Decomposition of the upper level WBS component requires subdividing the work for each of the deliverables or subcomponents into the most fundamental component. As the work is decomposed to greater levels of detail, the ability to plan, manage, and control the work is enhanced. What is the output? What is it that we are going to get? We get the scope baseline. A one mark question for you here. The scope baseline is an approved version of the scope statement. WBS and its associated WBS dictionary, which can be changed only through the formal change control process and is used as a basis for composition. It is a component of the project's management plan. Project scope statement, WBS, work package, planning package, WBS dictionary, all these are a part of the project management plan. And your project documents also get updated. Your assumption log, requirement document, etc. gets updated. Yeah, so let's see a quick summary of what we did today. So we did plan scope management, the process of creating a scope management plan that documents how the project and the product scope will be defined, validated, and controlled. What did you do during collect requirement? The process of determining, documenting, and managing stakeholders' need and requirement to meet the project objective. That is the process that you follow for collect requirement. Then what are you going to do during define scope? The process of defining a detailed description of the project as well as of the product. And while doing WBS, the process of subdividing the project deliverables and project work into smaller, more manageable components. Got that? So these are the four processes of the planning process group under project scope management. So guys, that is it from my end for today's session. You can also view project integration management and project scope management that we've done in the previous session. In the coming up videos, we are going to talk about project scope management, monitoring and controlling, which includes two processes, which is part two for us. Till then, like, share and comment on my videos. Do subscribe to my channel and keep correcting, keep studying, and all the best.